Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this evening episode of Pursue. And this is Pursue 19H, which is hemostasis and thrombosis. We are streaming live from Apollo Gleneagles Hospital, Kolkata. We have a very interesting topic today, which is inherited deficiencies of coagulation, dealing with factor 2, 5, 5 and 8, 7, 10, 11 and 13. And to talk on that, we have a young, very vibrant, very knowledgeable person, Dr. Sulagna Giri. She is an MBBS, MD from TNMC and BYL Nair Medical College, Mumbai, DNB. She is presently a junior consultant in the Department of Pathology at the Apollo Multispeciality Hospital, Kolkata. She has been the ex-assistant professor in the Department of Pathology, Grand Medical College and Sir JJ Group of Hospitals, with multiple publications in national and international journals, special interest in automation in hematology, benign hematology and coagulation disorder. So no better person than Dr. Sulagna Giri to talk on coagulation. Before I ask her to start, let me request all of you to keep your mic muted, your camera off, and please don't share your screen. With this, let me request Dr. Sulagna Giri, ma'am, please share your screen and let's start.
Yes, sir. Okay, thank you so much, sir. Okay. Am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible. Just press that hide thing so that that.
Okay, yes, sir.
Yeah, now start, please. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for the introduction. First of all, I want to thank you for giving me this opportunity. Currently, I'm going to present the inherited deficiencies of coagulation factor 2, 5, and combined factor 5 and 8, factor 7, 10, 11, and 13. So first, to start with, what are the coagulation disorders? Coagulation disorder are conditions that affect blood's clotting activity. So it can be either due to clotting factor deficiency or dysfunction. It can be both inherited or acquired type, where inherited are the most common type. Coagulation disorder can result in either a hemorrhage, which is insufficient clotting that cause increased risk of bleeding, or thrombosis, which is excessive clotting that cause blood clots to obstruct the blood flow. So by now, I think all of you must have been very familiar with this figure. So it is nothing but the coagulation cascade. So there are three pathways: intrinsic, extrinsic, and the common pathway. Extrinsic pathway starts with activation of factor 7. And intrinsic pathway starts from activation of factor 12. And common pathway starts with activation of factor 10, which finally leads to a cross-linked fibrin clot. Factor 11 helped in cross-linking of the fibrin clot by formation of the fibrin polymer from fibrin monomer. So any abnormality or deficiency of extrinsic factor pathway factors, which are factor 7, the PT will be increased. Or any deficiency of the factors which is associated with the intrinsic pathway, like factor 12, factor 11, factor 9, there will be increase of APTT. And any deficiency in the factor associated with the common pathway, which is factor 10, 5, fibrinogen, prothrombin, will cause both increased of APTT and PT. So here is the chart showing all the factors with their biological half-life and their blood product source. So we can see factor 1 to 13 here. So all the coagulation factors are numbered with Roman numerals in order of their discovery. So there is no factor 6, and the most common synonyms are also written here. So factor 1 is also known as fibrinogen, factor 2 as prothrombin, factor 5 as proacyclidine, factor 8 and 9 is, as all of you know, antihemophilic factor and Christmas factor. Factor 10 is also known as a Stuart power factor, like that. So you can see the factor 7 has the shortest half-life, which is 4 to 6 hours, and factor 1 and factor 13 has the longest half-life of almost 150 hours. We'll talk about the blood product source later. So inherited, I already told you, coagulation disorder can be inherited or acquired, where inherited coagulation disorder are most common. So what are the inherited abnormalities? We know hemophilia A and hemophilia B and Voll reprint. By now, all of you are very familiar with this topic. But today, we are going to discuss inherited deficiency of other factors, which are the rare in occurrence. Those are factor 1, 2, 5, 5 and 8 combined, factor 7, 10, 11 and 13. So clinical severity of all these inherited coagulation disorder mostly depend upon the type and the plasma level of the factor affected. So again, hemophilia A and B are the most severe, most important inherited bleeding disorder. And together with von Willebrand disease, this X-linked disorder includes 95% to 97% of the all inherited deficiency of coagulation factor. But today we are going to discuss remaining 3% to 5% of the inherited factor deficiency, which is also known as the rare bleeding disorder or RBDs. So what are the RBDs? The rare inherited coagulation disorder are inherited abnormalities of hemostasis that may cause significant difficulties in diagnosis and management. As those factors are rare in occurrence, so they may cause difficulties in diagnosis. So overall frequency of this disorder in the general population is low. Homozygous deficiency varies from 1 in 50,000 for factor 7 to 1 in 2 million for factor 2, which is also known as prothrombin factor. All the rare disorders are autosomally recessive except the factor 11, which can be both autosomally recessive and autosomally dominant. Here is the chart showing all the factors with their pattern of inheritance and also their incident. So you can see factor 2, 5, 8, factor 2, 5, 7, factor 9, factor 10, factor 13, all are autosomally recessive. Factor 11 is both autosomal dominant and recessive. Incident is, you can see, though these are all rare disorder, but among them, factor 7 has the highest incident rate of 1 is to 50,000. And also, factor 11 and factor 2 as the rarest, as prevalence of it is 1 in 2 million. The prevalence of this disorder is strongly influenced by the racial mix in the population. There may be considerable variation in breeding pattern between the affected individual. That means if two different individuals are affected with one rare bleeding disorder, if they have same amount of factor activity, they can show different severity in clinical presentation and also pattern of bleeding. So there are considerable variation in bleeding pattern between affected individual. Diagnosis and monitoring of affected individual may require specialist phenotyping and molecular investigation. The evaluation of the all worldwide RBD distribution are mostly relies on two large surveys. One is led by the World Federation of Hemophilia, WFH, and another is the European Network of the Rare Bleeding Disorder, also known as ENRBD. The WHF began collecting data around 2004, whereas ENRBD project began in 2007. So all the data are mostly come from these two different surveys. So this, again, from this survey, you came to know the factor 7 is the most common in occurrence among the all rare disorder, followed by the factor 11. So what are the clinical presentation? How they present? So first of all, I'm giving you a general overview of all this disorder. Later on, we are going to discuss individual entity in brief. So generally, heterozygous have no significant clinical manifestation. Severe deficiency are more likely to be found in population where consanguineous marriage is common. In rare cases, individually may have inherited more than one disorder. So we all know the hemophilia is X-linked. So the women are not generally affected, but unlike hemophilia in RBD, the women are equally affected as these are all autosomally recessive or dominant in pattern. Each RBD or rare bleeding disorder can have several bleeding symptoms ranging from minor post-traumatic to severe episode of appearing as severe episode. They may appear at birth as a umbilical cord bleeding or later in life. Clinical symptom among RBD patient may significantly significantly between disorder and patient, even when affected with same disorder. As I told you earlier, the two different patients with same factor disorder, with same level of factor activity, can present differently clinically. One may have the minor symptom, other may have the severe bleeding. Mucocutaneous and surgical associated bleeding were reported in around 20% of patients. Post-traumatic hemarthrosis and hematoma are actually rare with this rare bleeding disorder, though factor 7 or factor 10 deficiency can show some post-traumatic hemarthrosis or hematoma. But it is rare, unlike hemophilia. So I told you earlier that women are equally affected by men in RBD. So menorrhagia, spontaneous abortion, or bleeding during vaginal delivery were reported around 20% of women with all deficiencies. Affected females are also at increased risk of hemorrhagic ovarian cyst, endometriosis, endometrial hyperplasia, polyps, and fibroid. Pregnancy and childbirth pose particular clinical challenges like miscarriages, bleeding during pregnancy, and postpartum hemorrhage. So special care is needed while handling women with rare bleeding disorder, especially during childbirth. This is a study from the European Network of Rare Bleeding Disorder that is conducted. The surveys are based on 489 patients and from 13 different European treatment centers. This study was done to explore the relationship between coagulation factor activity and the clinical bleeding severity. So what we can see, they have divided the clinical bleeding episode in four categories, starting from asymptomatic one to grade three bleeding. Asymptomatic one has no documented bleeding episode. Grade one bleeding had bleeding that occurred after trauma or drug ingestion. Grade two bleeding is defined as spontaneous minor bleeding like bruising, ecchymosis, minor wound, oral cavity bleeding, epistaxis on menorrhagia. And grade three bleeding is spontaneous major bleeding like hematoma, hematosis, GI bleeding, CNS, ICH, umbilical cord bleeding. So this study has documented a strong association between residual coagulant activity and clinical bleeding severity for deficiency of fibrinogen, which is factor 1, combined factor 5 and 8, factor 10 and factor 13. That means all these factors are the coagulant activity and the clinical bleeding severity has a equal relationship. Like if the factor, when the factor levels is below the 1% level, they will show, the patient will show severe symptom. But weak association was found between factor 5 and factor 7. Residual factor 11 activity did not predict clinical bleeding severity. So with factor 5, factor 7 and factor 11, there is weak association between coagulant activity and the severity of bleeding. That means the patient with mildly reduced coagulant activity can show severe bleeding. From the same study, it was documented that the minimal level to ensure complete absence, which is also known as a hemostatic level, is different for each disorder. That means the every factor will have a different hemostatic level to ensure complete absence of clinical symptoms. These are the common symptoms: easy bruising, ecchymosis, hematosis, deep tissue hematoma, which are severe, posterior epistaxis, GI bleeding, urinary bleeding. So how do you diagnose a case of rare bleeding disorder? So anything to diagnose, first we want the patient history. So we want patient personal and family history. So any family member or patient parents are also having the similar kind of symptom or bleeding trend history. So we'll ask for that. And personal history is mainly the type of bleeding, the frequency of bleeding, the severity of bleeding. Is it a mild bleeding? And the site of bleeding, which is very important. So we'll ask for the patient history first. So next we'll go to the screening test. Screening test is what? Screening test will do CBC, BT, PT, APTT and TT. PT, APTT and TT is for coagulation screening test, where CBC and BT are done mostly to rule out any platelet disorder. So thrombocytopenia or any increased bleeding time. So patient may have a associated abnormality in platelet also. So to rule out platelet disorder, we will have CBC and BT as a screening test. And also coagulation screening tests are PT, APTT and TT. We can also do 50-50 mixing study in order to rule out presence of any inhibitor. So in any case, If the PT, APT or TT is abnormal, next thing we can do is a 50-50 mixing study to rule out any presence of any inhibitor. Coagulation factor assay. This is a definite coagulation factor assay, which can be more, which can be two type, qualitative and quantitative. Qualitative factor, we mostly do qualitative coagulation factor assay. Quantitative assay is done only in specific cases like factor 2. Global hemostatic test, which is also known as thromboblastin generation time and molecular diagnosis. We'll discuss all those in brief. Coagulation screening tests include APTT, TT and PT. So abnormal screening coagulation test are followed by the mixing study to exclude an inhibitor. The screening clotting test, PT, APTT, fibrinogen, platelet count and bleeding time, all of these are normal in case of factor 13 deficiency. So to diagnose factor 13, we have to do coagulation factor assay, specific assay for factor 13, which I will tell you later. So this is a screening test. Complete blood count has been done with coagulation screen. So first we see platelet is abnormal, PT is abnormal, sorry. So if the PT is abnormal, you can say there is abnormality in the extrinsic pathway. So there is factor 7 abnormality. So if the APTT is abnormal, you can see there is abnormality in the intrinsic pathway. So which is factor 8, factor 9 and factor 11. So if the PT and APTT both are abnormal, factor 5 and factor 10 too is to be considered. Thrombocytopenia is a platelet disorder. So no abnormality, we can consider factor 11. Laboratory tests are used for investigation and diagnosis. These all tests are affected by method of collection and processing. So coagulation tests are very sensitive tests. We have to do it in proper way, as well as a choice and execution. A good venipuncture with free flowing blood is essential. Choice of anticoagulant is 3.2% trisodium citrate vial taken in 1:9 ratio, and you have to fill it properly up to the mark. Poor or difficult venipuncture may result in tissue activation in the sample, and therefore false normal result even in a severe coagulation disorder. So venipuncture with free flow blood collection is very important to for coagulation test. Samples should be centrifuged as soon as possible, and all coagulation tests should be done within 4 hours of collection. If is there any delay in doing the test, we can separate the plasma, that too within 4 hours by centrifuging the sample, and we can freeze the plasma in -220°C for 4 to 6 weeks, or -80°C up to 1 year. So any thawed plasma, any frozen plasma has to be thawed rapidly before doing the assay. So molecular diagnosis is based on the causative mutation identification in gene encoding corresponding coagulation. The exception is the combined factor 5 and factor 8 deficiency. Except the combined factor 5 and factor 8 deficiency, all the genes are mutated according to their corresponding coagulation factor. That means in factor 2 deficiency, the corresponding gene of factor 2 is to be mutated. And factor 8 deficiency, and combined factor 5 and 8 deficiency caused by the mutation in the genes encoding protein involved in the factor 5 and factor 8 intracellular transfer. That means the intracellular transfer protein is mutated here, not the corresponding gene to factor 5 and factor 8. The intracellular transport gene, also known as LMAN1 and MCFD2. Inheritance pattern is autosomal recessive. I already told you for all RBDs except for the some case of factor 11, which can be both autosomal recessive or dominant. So what are the type of mutation we see in these RBDs? Are most common is the missense mutation, representing around 50% to 80% of the all mutation. Second most common is the insertion or deletion, representing 20 to 30% of the gene mutation, except the LMAN1 variant, where the most common mutation is the insertion or deletion, that can be seen in around 50%. Third most common mutation is the splicing and nonsense mutation, which comprise of around 5 to 15% of the coagulation factor inherited mutations. 5 to 10% of the affected patients with severe deficiency have no identifiable genetic defect. So So there have no genetic mutation detected. To use of NGS, that is next generation sequencing, correlated with the additional investigation may elucidate novel genetic pathway. So all these 5 to 10% of the unknown genetic defect can be revealed by doing NGS with additional investigation. This is a chart showing all the factors with their prevalence with their gene involved. So we can see the prothrombin factor 2, the gene mutated here is the factor 2 gene. So factor 5, the mutated gene is the factor 5 gene. So only exception is the combined factor 5 and factor 8, where the transport protein gene is mutated, that is LMN1 and MCFD2. So next is the coagulation factor assay. Coagulation factor assay is the based on PT and APTT method. This is done by using mixture of patient plasma and the factor deficient plasma. The factor deficient plasma contains all the coagulation factor except the factor to be examined. So then next the clotting time is noted. Next the clotting time is compared with the reference graph. The reference graph is prepared using various dilution of standard or normal plasma mixed with factor deficient plasma. So one reference graph is made by using normal plasma admixed with the factor deficient plasma. Then again patient plasma, mixture of patient plasma and factor deficient plasma, the clotting time is noted and this clotting time is plotted against the standard curve. So 1:10 dilution of the standard plasma represent 100% activity. And normal level of all coagulation factor is 5 to 150%, which is 50 normal level of all coagulation factor is 50 to 150% or 50 to 150 international unit. So I told you earlier factor 13 deficiency. So the PT, APTT, all the screening tests like PT, APTT, TT are actually normal. So in factor 13 deficiency, we have to do a factor 13 qualitative assay. Factor 13 helps in forming of the fibrin polymer from fibrin monomer. So in factor 13 qualitative assay, fibrin clot is unstable, and in case of factor 13 deficiency, the fibrin clot is unstable and dissolved in 1% monochloroacetic acid or 5m urea solution. So the clot formed in factor 13 deficient blood, the clot is instable and dissolved in 1% monochloroacetic acid or 5m urea solution. By this test, we can qualitatively assay the factor 13 deficiency. When factor 13 activity is decreased, the deficiency subtype factor 13A or factor 13B is determined with immunological factor 13 antigen assay to assure appropriate classification and treatment. Factor 13 deficiency is again divided into type A and type B. I will tell you later. So if any bird is found to be factor 13 deficit, then again we can do immunological assay to detect which is a type of factor 13A or factor 13B deficiency. Factor antigenic assay are essential for diagnosis of quantitative deficiency of factor 2 to appropriately classify and treat patient with this prothrombinia. So factor antigenic assay are also important. So factor antigenic assay cause quantitative can detect quantitative deficiency. So in case of factor 2 deficiency, this prothrombinemia can be detected by the antigenic assay. It is a quantitative study, not a qualitative study. Next is the global hemostatic test. Test evaluating global hemostatic activity, also known as thrombin generation test or TGT, can provide more accurate evaluation. Recently, this test have been used to evaluate hemostasis in patient with RBDs, especially factor 5 and factor 11 deficiency. These assays represent an emerging strategy to determine therapeutic effectiveness and to monitor RBD treatment, particularly in factor 11 deficiency, where standard assay failed to correlate with the bleeding risk. So I told you earlier, factor 7, factor 11 and factor 10, there is no correlation between the coagulant activity and the bleeding risk of the patient. So from all these cases, global hemostatic test or TGT are very useful to detect the deficiency. So again, what patient came to your department? So you first take the clinical history of the patient. Next, the screening study to be done, which is CBC, blood smear, PT, APTT, bleeding time, and platelet function. So if you find no abnormalities, you can think about factor 13 deficiency. So if there is abnormality in CBC, which is in the form of thrombocytopenia, or if there is increased bleeding time, there could be a platelet disorder, that this can be congenital or acquired, or also it could be a von Willebrand disease. But today our concern is the PT-APTT abnormal part. So APTT is prolonged in case of intrinsic pathway deficiency, factor deficiency, which are factor 8, factor 11, and factor 9. PT is only prolonged in factor 7 deficiency. Both are prolonged in factor 5 and 10 deficiency. So one patient came in the department, you first have to take the clinical history, then the screening studies to be done. Then according to the screening study, you can differentiate the patient of bleeding disorder, like patient is having any platelet abnormalities or patient is having any coagulation abnormalities. And also with PT and APTT, you can further differentiate the type of coagulation activity, the abnormality the patient having. So coming to the treatment part, most RBD treatment is are on demand. That means as soon as possible after blood bleeding onset. So treatment mainstay is replacement of the deficient coagulated factor and use of adjunctive therapies that are antifibrinolytic, estrogen or progesterone to reduce the bleeding. Doses and treatment frequency depend on the required minimal hemostatic level of each coagulation factor, its plasma half-life, and the type of bleeding episode treated or to be prevented. So the dose or the treatment frequency is depend upon the coagulation factor hemostatic level and its plasma half-life. So that means the factor with low with the shortest plasma half-life will have more frequent require more frequent treatment than the factors with longest half-life. The type of bleeding episode treated: phase present plasma, preferably virus inactivated, prothrombin concentrate complex, and virally inactivated specific factor concentrate. All these are the treatment option. So fresh frozen plasma contain all the factors. Prothrombin concentrate complex contain factor 2, factor 9, factor 10, and sometimes factor 7. Cryoprecipitate contain fibrinogen, factor 13, von Willebrand factor, and fibronectin, and factor 13. So we have all the treatment option: phase present plasma, PCC, and virally inactivated specific factor concentrate. The patient personal family bleeding history are important management guides, are important in management guides. Adjuvant therapy such as antifibrinolytic alone or in combination with replacement therapy and estrogen progesterone preparation are considered for less severe mucosal tract hemorrhage or heavy bleeding, menstrual bleeding. Clinically severe cases or specific deficiency state, prophylactic treatment is considered. So not all cases require prophylactic treatment. Only clinically severe cases or any specific factor deficiency states require prophylactic treatment. Nowadays, recombinant technology and virally inactivated blood concentrate methods have virtually eliminated the risk of blood-borne infection and other potential concentrate-related adverse effect, which are inhibitor development, thrombosis, or hypersensitivity reaction. So by use of recombinant factors and the viral inactivated blood concentrate, we can eliminate the risk of having the adverse effect or blood-borne infection. Causes of autoantibody has been reported in fibrinogen, factor 2, factor 7, factor 11, and factor 13 deficiency following replacement therapy. So now coming to the each entity in brief. So first, to start with the prothrombin factor or factor 2 deficiency. Factor 2 is a vitamin K dependent glycogen synthesized by the liver and encoded by the factor 2 gene, which is located on chromosome 11. This is a single chain glycoprotein with four domains. The factor 10A activates it on the surface of platelet, releasing an activated peptide, which is fragment 1.2 on cleavage. So factor 10A activates it on the surface of platelet. It is the rarest of inherited. I already told you the factor 2 and factor 13 are the rarest inherited coagulation disorder with prevalence of 1 in 2 million. So again, This can be two type. Type 1, also known as hypoprothrombinemia, where both anticoagulant activity and antigen level are low. And it can be type 2 dysprothrombinemia, where their factor synthesis is normal, only the protein is dysfunctional. So it can be of type 1, which is hypoprothrombinemia, or type 2, which is dysprothrombinemia. In knockout mice model, we can see the complete absence are actually incompatible with life, which is lethal. Only a small number of cases are reported worldwide, and the largest series of 14 patients are seen from the Iran. Clinical representation, the plasma level below, factor 2 plasma level below 5% are seen in the homozygous or double heterozygous patient. Patient present with severe bleeding. In case of homozygous and double heterozygous patient, they present with severe bleeding, including prolonged post-injury bleeding, mucosal bleeding, subcutaneous and muscle hematoma. Dysprothrombinemia usually shows less severe bleeding tendency than the true deficiency, and it has more valuable clinical features. So dysprothrombinemia show less severe bleeding than the hyperprothrombinemia state, and this has also more variable clinical feature. Heterozygous patients are usually asymptomatic, except episodes of severe bleeding after surgical episode can be observed. In homozygous female, menorrhagia is frequent. So these are the all common symptoms you can see. The severe bleeding in former prolonged post-injury bleeding, mucosal bleeding, subcutaneous and muscle hematoma, you can see in all coagulation disorder. Along with the homozygous female, they can present with the menorrhagia. Laboratory investigation, prothrombin is a common pathway factor. So both the prothrombin time and activated partial thrombopoietin time, which is APTT, will be prolonged. So you can see in screening, you can see both increased in PT and APTT. For the definitive diagnosis, factor 2 assay may be performed by variety of method, and particular caution is taken for the infants. Treatment is FFP or PCC. So FFP content, all coagulation factor, PCC content, factor 2, factor 7, factor 9 and 10. Replacement therapy is needed only in severe patient presented with bleeding or before any surgical procedure. Higher levels of prothrombin may be achieved by PCC than FFP. So PCC is the treatment of choice here. Other vitamin K dependent factor present in the PCC, like factor 7, 9 or 10, may induce thrombotic complication. The next is factor 5 deficiency. Factor 5, again a large glycoprotein with 40% sequence homology with factor 7 in the A and C domains and a similar overall structure. So factor 5 have a homology to a sequence 40% sequence homology to factor 8 in the A and C domain. So factor 5 is mainly secreted by the hepatocyte. It can also synthesized in vivo in the platelet or megakaryocyte. So it has two secretion sites. One is from the hepatocyte, other is from the platelet and megakaryocyte lineage. So platelet and megakaryocyte lineage are also the factor 5, which is secreted from the platelet and megakaryocyte lineage, are also known as the platelet part of the factor 5. Factor 5 protein is encoded by a large and complete F5 gene, which is located on chromosome 1. And it is rare in occurrence. Of prevalence is 1 in 1 million. So which role factor 5 plays in coagulation process? So factor 5 is a common pathway factor. So it acts as a protein cofactor required by the prothrombin H complex for thrombin generation. And it contributes to the anticoagulant pathway by down-regulating factor 3. So it can act as a, it plays a double role, both in the coagulation pathway and in the anticoagulant pathway. In coagulation pathway, they help in thrombin generation, and in anticoagulant pathway, they help in down-regulating factor 13. Factor 5 deficiency again is of two types. Type 1 deficiency, which is concomitant deficiency of factor 5 activity and antigen 11. This is more common type. And factor 2, where the presence of dysfunctional protein. That means the protein synthesis is normal, but the protein is dysfunctional, which is type 2 deficiency. The clinical presentation again variable. Severely deficient individual may have less than 1 to 10 international unit of factor, with moderately severe bleeding tendency which may represent in the childhood in the form of easy bruising, mucous membrane bleeding, especially epistaxis. Symptomatic patient usually present with skin and mucosal tract hemorrhage, epistaxis and menorrhagia. Postoperative and oral cavity hemorrhages are also common. Severe symptoms include hemarthrosis, GI and CNS bleeding, though it is rare. Joint and muscle bleeding may also occur, but usually less than the hemophilia. So joint, the hemarthrosis and hematomas, though rare, but can occur in case of factor V deficiency. ICH has also been reported in infancy. So the factor V, the platelet counterpart of the factor V, which are synthesized from the megakaryocyte, has some specific features. They, after synthesized from the megakaryocyte, they are endocytosed by the megakaryocyte from the plasma pool. Then it is modified intracellularly to gain a unique physical and functional characteristic. So after modifying, they became more procoagulant than its plasma counterpart. So actually, the platelet counterpart of factor V is more procoagulant than its plasma counterpart. Platelet degranulation and release of factor V contributes to a high concentration in vascular injury. So in case of vascular injury, so there are platelet degranulation occur. So that cause release of the platelet part of the factor V, and there is local high concentration of the platelet factor V. So locally released factor V is less susceptible to inhibition and may function normally in hemostasis. So this is a unique feature of factor V. There they have the platelet counterpart, which can be released locally during vascular injury, which is less susceptible to inhibition and may function normally in hemostasis. Laboratory investigation, again, a factor of common pathway, so both PT and EPTT are prolonged. The diagnosis is confirmed by the performing factor V assay. The factor 8 assay should also be performed to exclude combined deficiency. So next we will discuss combined factor 5 and 8 deficiency. So in case we found factor 5 deficiency, we need to exclude factor 8 deficiency also. Treatment, there is no factor 5 containing concentrate. So there is no specific factor 5 concentrate. So again, the treatment option is FAP, preferably virus inactivated. The minimum hemostatic level to stop the clinical bleeding has been reported as the 15 international unit. Large volume of plasma may be needed for to reach that hemostatic level. Platelet transfusion with factor 5 in the granules may be of benefit. So as platelet contain factor 5 in their granules, the platelet transfusion with factor 5 in their granules may be of some benefit in case of treating factor 5 deficiency patient. To watch infant with care and perform a cranial ultrasound within the first few days of life. So any child with heterozygous parents, so we should do an ultrasound within first few days of life to rule out any intracranial hemorrhage. Preclinical trials of factor 5 concentrate is currently being performed by FDA and EMA in order to make it available on market as soon as possible. The next, coming to the combined deficiency of factor 5 and factor 8. This is of particular interest as this is the first coagulation disorder attributable to gene defect outside the coagulation factor gene themselves. So as I told you earlier, this combined deficiency of factor 5 and factor 8 occur due to defect in the transport gene mutation. So these are caused by the abnormal transport through the endoplasmic reticulum due to defect in LMAN1 gene, previously known as the ERGIC53, this gene is coded on chromosome 18. So in the combined deficiency of factor 5, you can see both low levels of factor 5 and factor 8. In 2013, another gene associated with this deficiency was identified. This was named as MCFD2 gene. So MCFD2 gene and LMAN1 gene are the two transport gene which is mutated in combined deficiency of factor 8 and factor 5. But MCFD2 gene acts as a cofactor for LMAN1. Phenotype associated with mutation and mutation in LMAN1 and MCFD2 gene are indistinguishable. Clinical presentation. The patient usually patient with mild symptom like easy bruising, epistaxis, bleeding occurs after surgery or dental extraction. The factor levels are usually not below 1% or 1 international unit, so the spontaneous bleeding is rare. Only mild bleeding can be seen. Women may have menorrhagia and postpartum hemorrhage. Severe symptom like hemarthrosis, GI or CNS bleeding, though present, but is very rare in occurrence. Laboratory investigation, again, both factor 8 is a intrinsic factor pathway factor. So, and factor 5 is a common pathway factor. So both APTT and PT are prolonged, with latter being disproportionately long, which is APTT will be disproportionately long, but both APTT and TT will be increased in combined efficiency of factor 5 and factor 8. Factor 5 and factor 8 levels are generally between 5 to 20 international unit. Treatment, mild cases do not require regular prophylaxis and are treated on demand. Desmopressin can be of use. Both factor 5 and factor 8 level must be corrected using FFP. Desired level of factor 5 is 25 international unit, and for factor 8, before doing any minor procedure, the factor 8 level has to rise above 25, and for many major procedure, the level has to be more than 50 international unit. Neonatal ICH has not been reported in this combined deficiency of factor 5 and factor 8. Coming to factor 7 deficiency, factor 7 is a extrinsic pathway factor. This is one of the vitamin K dependent glycoprotein, which is synthesized in the liver, and it's encoded by F7 gene located in the chromosome 13. Factor 7 deficiency is the commonest autosomal recessive rare coagulation disorder, with frequency of 1 in 50,000 of general population. Diagnosis of heterozygous state is complicated by the considerable variation of label in normal population due to both inherited gene polymorphism and acquired, which is dietary factor, age and obesity. So diagnosis of heterozygous state in factor 7 deficiency is little complicated, because the F7 gene can show polymorphism, and also it is affected by the acquired factors like dietary fat, age and obesity. Patient may have concomitant low levels of factor 7 antigen and factor 7 coagulant activity. So again, with factor 7, this is of two type. One is patient having low level of both factor 7 antigen and factor 7 coagulant. And second type is a factor 7 with normal with low level of and coagulant activity is low, with normal or low factor 7 antigen activity. So patient, again, this is of two type. One is both the antigen and coagulant activity is low, and the second type is the only coagulant activity is low with normal or low borderline antigenic activity. In addition, reagent like thromboplastin can markedly affect the assay result. Clinical presentation, again, there is relatively poor correlation between factor 7 level and the wide variety of bleeding manifestation. So factor 7, again, there is no proportion between the coagulation factor level in our blood and also with the bleeding tendency. Mucous membrane bleeding, including epistaxis and menorrhagia, is common. Some patients with severe deficiency have suffered ICH, often in the neonatal period, or joint bleeding. Severe deficiency can show joint bleeding or ICH. Occasionally, patients have paradoxical thrombosis, mechanism of which is not understood properly. Thrombosis particularly seen in the presence of surgery or replacement therapy, but can be spontaneous also. So the paradoxical thrombosis can be seen in factor 7 deficiency, the mechanism is of which is not understood, but it can occur mostly in the presence of surgery or any replacement therapy. So laboratory investigation of factor 7, as it is a factor of extrinsic pathway, only PT will be prolonged, or all the other screening tests are normal. Factor 7 assay, factor 7 and assayed in a one-stage prothrombin based assay. So we can assay the factor 7 by coagulation factor assay. Human thromboplastin may give a better reflection of in vivo levels than the animal thromboplastin. So human thromboplastin used to do global hemostatic test are better than the animal thromboplastin. blood sample should not be stored in the ice before the assay, because it can activate factor 7. The cold activation can occur, so that can cause a overestimation of factor 7, which can lead a false negative diagnosis. Treatment of factor 7 deficiency: people with heterozygous deficiency do not have any abnormal bleeding risk. Viral inactivated plasma derived factor 7 concentrate have been available and are effective. Factor 9 and Prothrom PCC containing factor 7 are also used, but carry a risk of thrombosis and are no longer recommended. So PCC and factor 9 concentrate are of treatment of choice, but nowadays they carry a risk of thrombosis, so this is no longer recommended. So we can use factor 7 concentrate, which is virus inactivated, as a treatment of choice. But nowadays recombinant factor 7 is also available and called as a treatment of choice, and is now licensed for use in this condition. The dose required is much lower than that used for patient with factor 8 inhibitors. The half-life of factor 7 is short, and treatment need to be given every 2 to 4 hours. As the factor 7 half-life is short, the treatment has to be given every 2 to 4 hours. So the shortest half-life factor 7 is having of 2 to 4 hours. So treatment has to be given in every 2 to 4 hours. The hemostatic level is probably 10 to 15 international unit. So by reaching this international unit level, 10 to 15 international unit, the hemostatic level can be achieved with the factor 7 deficiency. In families where both parents are known to have heterozygous deficiency, preparation of the delivery of a potentially affected newborn includes making a careful management plan with the obstetrician and the pediatrician to avoid any, and also avoidance of instrumental delivery. So in scenario where both the parents are heterozygous, there are chance the newborn is affected either by double heterozygous or homozygous state. So in that scenario, careful management has to be taken and no instrumental delivery is to be done. Severely affected newborn is at risk for ICH in the neonatal period. Pregnancy itself does not require any specific precaution. Postmortem bleeding may occur in women with low levels of factor 7 who did not receive any prophylaxis. So postmortem bleeding may occur in pregnant women with low levels of factor 7 who did not receive any prophylaxis. Coming to factor 10 deficiency. Factor 10 is a vitamin K dependent protease and has a key role in coagulation pathway. It is the first enzyme in the common pathway and the most important activator of prothrombin. So common pathway starts with the activation of factor 10. So it is a vitamin K dependent protease and has a key role in the coagulation pathway. In association with the factor 5A and phospholipid membranes, the factor 10A accelerates the conversion of prothrombin to thrombin. So factor A helps in conversion of from prothrombin to thrombin by 280,000 fold. Factor 10 is synthesized in the liver and encoded by the factor 10 gene located in the chromosome 13. The overall frequency of severe deficiency is estimated to be 1 in 1 million of general population. Although most heterozygous do not have any symptoms, some may present with significant bleeding history. So again, two phenotypes identified. One, both coagulant and anti-GML levels are low. Two, low coagulant level with normal or low borderline antigen level. Again, every rare bleeding disorder can have two phenotypes. One with both coagulant and antigen levels are low. Second is the low coagulant level with normal or low borderline antigen level. Clinical presentation. Bleeding tendency may appear at any age. Epistaxis and menorrhagia can be seen in around 50% of women and are the most common presenting symptom. Severe deficiency of factor 8, which is less than 1% of the coagulant activity, present early in life with umbilical stump bleeding, GI or CNS bleeding. So for any factor, severe factor deficiency is considered where the factor is less than 1%, where the coagulant activity is less than 1%. So in case of factor 10, where the coagulant activity is less than 1%, the severe bleeding may occur in form of umbilical stump bleeding, GI or CNS bleeding. Hematosis and hematomas are common in severe factor 10 deficiency. Laboratory investigation, again a common pathway factor. So both PT and APGT is increased. Deficiency is confirmed by factor 10 assay. Several different assay methods are available, PT or APTT based, the coagulation factor assay can be done on PT-APTT based method or chromogenic or immunological method. The result may vary depending upon the source of thromboplastin use. Treatment of factor 10 deficiency. The hemostatic level of factor 10 postoperatively is thought to be 10 to 20 international unit, and the half-life of factor 10 is 60 hours. So there is no factor 10 concentrate, but PCC can contain factor 10 and are effective. So one international unit of factor 8 raised the factor 8 factor 10 sorry one international unit of factor 10 raised the factor 10 level by 1.5%. These concentrates are associated with a thrombotic risk, as with any PCC complex or any concentrate infusion, there is increased risk of thrombotic event and should be used with caution in those patients with additional risk factor. So any patient with having additional health issues, the concentrate should be used with precaution. Data from UK Hemophilia Centre Doctors Organisation shows that the proportion of factor 10 deficient patient requiring treatment is more than other rare factor deficiency. So factor 10 deficient patient require treatment more often than the other rare factor deficiency. So menorrhagia can be treated with both medical therapy and by surgical therapy. Antifibrinolytics, OCP, ribonucleosidase or IUD can be used as a medical therapy for menorrhagia. And if this is not controlled by the medical therapy, surgical procedure like endometrial ablation or hysterectomy can be done to control the menorrhagia. Pregnant women with deficiency of factor 10 may require prophylaxis therapy to deal with adverse pregnancy outcome like abortion, placental abrasion or PPH. Children with repeated joint bleeds may benefit from prophylaxis once or twice a week. APP, preferably viral inactivated, is an alternative. So FAP contain all the coagulation factor, so it can use as alternative. As the half-life in vivo varies in different individual, regular treatment and post-operative dosing should always be guided by the measurement of the level. Recently, clinical trial with freeze-dried human factor 10 and factor 9 has been going on. The freeze-dried human factor 10 and factor 9, the clinical trial of those two factors have been going on. Next, coming to the factor 11 deficiency. Factor 11 is a dimeric serine protease whose function is in coagulation is to recruit the extrinsic factor pathway after the tissue factor pathway has generated thrombin. So factor 11 is a the factor 11 is a dimeric serine protease whose function in coagulation is to recruit the intrinsic factor pathway after tissue factor. That means after the tissue factor, which is a extrinsic factor pathway, has generated thrombin, the intrinsic factor pathway is activated by activation of the factor 11. It is mainly synthesized by liver and sometimes from the megakaryocyte and platelets. Factor 11 is encoded by factor 11 gene located in the chromosome 4. And the prevalence of the disease is 1 in 1 million. The deficiency is particularly common in Ashkenazi's use, where the carrier rate is 8 to 9%. And we found two particular mutations in Ashkenazi's use. One is a stop codon in exon 5, also known as type 1, and a missense mutation in exon 9, also known as type 2 mutation, leading to reduced secretion of the molecule. These two kind of mutation we can found in, especially in Ashkenazi's use, leading to factor 11 deficiency. In the other population, the mutation are more variable. two phenotype identified. As with other rare bleeding disorder, both coagulant and antigel levels are low, which is most common type, and low coagulant level with normal or low borderline antigen level, which is rare. The pattern of inheritance is mainly autosomal recessive like other RBDs, but it can also inherited as an autosomal dominant pattern. So factor only exception is the factor 11, where the pattern of inheritance can be both autosomal recessive and autosomal dominant. Other RBDs are inherited as autosomal recessive. Clinical presentation, the relationship between plasma 11 level and bleeding tendency is not clear cut like other RBDs. The phenotype of bleeding does not correlate with the genotype. That means the two the same thing, the patient whose factor level are moderately low can present with the severe bleeding, and also the vice versa, where the patient with low factor level can show mild symptom or no symptom at all. So the relationship between factor 11 level and bleeding tendency is not clear cut. So the phenotype does not match with the genotype. Chances of bleeding from highly active fibronectic surface areas are more, which is 49% to 67%, than the less fibronectic area. Bleeding tendency may depend upon the level of other coagulation factors, such as factor 8 or vulnerable factor deficiency. So in case association with factor 8 and VWD, so there may be a severe bleeding pattern. Heterozygotes with factor 11 often have a bleeding risk than bleeding risk that is not well predicted by the factor 11 coagulants and coagulant level. So again, same thing. The phenotype of bleeding does not correlate with the genotype. That means the bleeding risk in heterozygotes is not well predicted by the factor 11 coagulant level. Women may have menorrhagia and bleeding after childbirth. Factor 11 deficient individual, which is where the factor 11 level are less than 10 international unit, have a mild bleeding tendency after surgery, especially in mouth, nose, genitourinary tract surgery. These all areas are known to be highly fibrinolytically active areas. So the chances of bleeding after surgery is more. Most common site of bleeding is oral and post-operative site is the occurs in more than 50% of the bleeding patient. Spontaneous bleeding is rare and hemarthrosis are not a feature. 70% pregnancy remain uneventful even without prophylactic therapy. The disorder rarely present in the neonatal period, so chances of neonatal ICH is low. ICH has not been reported, but bleeding may occur after circumcision. Laboratory investigation, the APTT is prolonged as factor 11 is a intrinsic factor pathway factor. So the APTT is prolonged and the diagnosis is established by the factor 11 assay, which is specific coagulation factor assay, factor 11 assay. The lower limit of normal range is in the region of 60 to 70 international unit. Therefore, the defect may be missed by the APTT testing. So the normal hemostatic level is quite high for the factor 11. So the factor 11 deficiency can be missed in the APTT testing. Caution is required since heterozygotes may bleed excessively after surgery and childbirth. So factor 11 again can be diagnosed by the TGT test, which is thromboplastin generation time test, and recently new plasma clot formation assays were demonstrated to be useful to distinguish phenotypes, with bleeders exhibiting significantly reduced fibrin network density and clot stability. So new plasma clot formation assay has been used to diagnose the factor 11 deficiency. Treatment is not straightforward, partly because of the variable bleeding tendency and the risk associated with the currently available factor 11 concentrate. FAP, preferably virus inactivated, is an alternative, but large volumes may be required. It is not clear what hemostatic level is adequate for surgery in severe deficiency, although a level of 30 international unit has been established for performance of surgery in severe deficiency, but the value is not clear. For those with mild deficiency who have a bleeding history, at baseline level above this, it is reasonable to aim at a level of 70 international units. So in case of mild deficiency with a bleeding history, the hemostatic level is the 70 international unit. Optimal management will therefore vary with individual circumstances. Another alternative treatment is recombinant factor 7a, but it is in a pilot study, thrombotic event has also been reported. Factor 11 concentrate is the appropriate therapy for severely deficient women during labor. So factor 11 concentrate is the treatment of choice in case of severely deficient women during labor. FFP can also be used, though the hemostatic level for factor 11 is not clear for doing performance surgery or in case of mild bleeders. Factor 13 deficiency. Factor 13 is a transglutaminase and function to cross-link the fibrin alpha and gamma gene. Factor 13 is a transglutaminase and its function is to cross-link the alpha and gamma fibrin chains, resulting in the stronger clot formation. So factor 13 causes formation of the fibrin polymer from fibrin monomer. And this stable clot causes increased resistance to the fibrinolysis. Factor 13 deficiency is rare, estimated 1 per 2 million of the general population. Heterozygotes are asymptomatic. The corresponding genes are located on chromosome 7 and chromosome 6 and 1. Alpha 2 plasmin inhibitor is also linked to the A chains of fibrin by 13A. Interestingly, the subunit, factor 13 is a tetramer with two A chain and two P chain. So A chain containing the thrombin cleavage site and the calcium binding site. And the B unit actually is a carrier for the activatable A unit. So this is a tetramer containing two A chain and two B chain. B unit is a carrier for the activatable A unit, and B chains are clipped away when factor 13 is activated. The activate molecule then stabilizes fibrin by cross-linking the gamma and alpha chains by formation of the lysine glutamine link. So it actually stabilizes the fibrin by cross-linking gamma and alpha chains by formation of the lysine and glutamine links. Those subunits called known as A and B has a different site of synthesis and location. The A subunit are located in the platelets, megakaryocytes and placenta, uterus and macrophages, and B subunits are synthesized in the liver. The majority of mutation associated with the factor 13 deficiency has been described for the A unit. Liver transplantation changes the B unit and leaving the A unit unchanged, and the bone marrow transplantation does the reverse. So in liver transplantation, the B subunit is which is changed, leaving the A unit unchanged, and in bone marrow transplantation, the reverse occurs. So clinical presentation, this disorder show considerable molecular heterogeneity and therefore variable clinical severity. Affected individuals tend to present early in life with excessive bleeding from the umbilical stem and at a risk of ICH. So in case of severe deficiency, the child can present with the umbilical stem bleeding and are at a risk of ICH. Ecchymosis, hematomas and prolonged bleeding following trauma is very common. Hemartosis and intramuscular hematoma may occur, though rare. Women of reproductive age group may present with miscarriage or intraperitoneal bleeding. Excessive skin bruising and bleeding can also occur. Once diagnosed, prophylaxis can alter the outcome of the disease. So laboratory investigation, I have already mentioned the factor 13 deficiency. There is no screening PT and APTT test abnormality. So PT and APTT will be normal in case of factor 13 deficiency. So all standard coagulation tests give normal result. Factor 13 qualitative assay is to be done. So the function of factor 13 is to formation of stable clot. So in case of factor 13 deficient state, the clot solubility is increased, which means the clot is easily soluble with suspension in 2% acetic acid or 5 mg urea solution. So by checking the clot solubility, we can say the patient plasma is factor 13 deficient or not. So we have to do factor 13 qualitative essay as all the standard coagulation tests give normal result. Various method of measurement of factor 13 are commercially available, but the rarity of the disorder makes the laboratory unfamiliar about the disease and also with the test. So this is a very rare condition. Many methods of measurement of factor 11 actually available, but most of the laboratory are unfamiliar about the disease and also with the test available to detect factor 13 deficiency. Though, as I told you, there is high risk of ICH and umbilical cord bleeding in case of factor 13 deficiency, and there people with severe deficiency and with risk of high risk of ICH should offer prophylaxis. Factor 13 concentrate is available, and due to long half-life, factor 13 is only needs to be given every 4 to 6 weeks. So factor 13 has the longest half-life of almost 150 hours. So this can be given, the treatment can be given every 4 to 6 weeks. Plasma level of factor 13 of 2 to 5% are sufficient to severe to prevent severe bleeding. So hemostatic level of plasma factor 13 is 2 to 5 international unit. ENRBD study showed that the patient with factor 13 deficiency need to reach a factor 13 coagulant activity more than 30% to remain completely asymptomatic. So to reach the state of completely asymptomatic, the factor 13 coagulant activity has to be more than 30%. Because of the difficulty of measuring factor 13 level, it is hard to make recommendation about the level of hemostatic level for surgery. So there is, as the all the screening test of factor 13 is in factor 13 deficiency is normal, so there is difficulty in measuring factor 13 level. So the hemostatic level is not clear cut in case of surgery. Plasma derived factor 13 has been used for several years and shown to be safe and effective. New recombinant factor 13 A2 concentrate is on phase 3 of clinical trial. So, coming to the conclusion, from all these rare bleeding disorder, we can all say the clinical expression is very variable, and it is more variable than the hemophilia. Each coagulation disorder can present with unique symptom, and the always the coagulant factor activity and the severity of bleeding is not always. So the clinical expression of the rare coagulation disorder is more variable than the hemophilia. So the rare coagulation disorders show more variable features than the hemophilia, and the coagulant activity does not correlate with the clinical severity of the bleeding. And this may present challenges in both diagnosis and management of the patient. So most of the lab doesn't have the coagulation factor assay of factor 2, 5 or combined factor 5 and 8, 9, 10. Most frequently we do factor 8 assay, but all this factor 2, 5, combined factor 5 and 8, 9, 10, all this factor is not done in general in our lab. So they may cause challenges in both diagnosis and also in the management. So any patient who's present with abnormal coagulation, we can rule out factor 8 by doing factor 8 assay, but we cannot say that the factor is deficient, the patient is deficient in which they are which coagulation factor. Awareness of this disorder in appropriate population groups will prompt a higher index of suspicion, thus earlier diagnosis of severely affected infants who are at a risk of serious bleeding, particularly ICH. So in case of severely affected infant, it is very necessary to the severely affected infants who are at a risk of serious bleeding, it is necessary to diagnose the patient to stop the disease to progress to the ICH. Okay, thank you.
Right. Thank you. So quite extensive and very nicely presented. You really worked hard. It's quite an extensive thing. And as you rightly said, recombinant factor 8 deficiency is very easy. And we have a method of trying to quantify and exactly find out whether the person is factor VIII deficient or not.
Yes.
But with regards to other factors, one really needs to understand and keep that in mind and maybe refer the patient to a specialized center where they do coagulation factor assay and try to analyze, because it is very essential. Otherwise, you know, patients might land up with intracranial bleed and maybe may die.
Yes.
So analysis of this is, and your summary is very important and very pertinent.
Yes.
Let me see if there are any questions on the YouTube or on the Google Meet.
Can I ask one question, Nadeem?
Yes, sir, please, sure.
Actually, I just chaired one session in hemophilia a few days ago, where all the people of the hematologists were present, and they told actually that the hemophilia B number in India is only 3,000. And the other, this rare bleeding disorder, coagulation factor is so rare that no laboratory do establish such assays. Most important thing is how to estimate the inhibitors. What are the methods of doing an inhibitors, particularly say all these bleeding disorder, ultimately whatever factor you give, they develop inhibitors. So detection of inhibitors are very important. So that is to be standardized possibly in our Kolkata laboratories.
Right. Yeah, you're right. Actually, if you really look at it, you know, these rare coagulation disorders are primarily more seen in the Jewish population. A lot of it in the Arabs, you know, the Arab, who are common Jew descendant. In our setup, thankfully, we are spared for this. Ideally speaking, on the theoretical point of view, we all really need to know about it.
Yeah, you should.
That is very essential. Yeah. And because it is not so common, so when it really presents, it's really a challenge for all of us.
Mm-hmm. The reality. Another important thing is that the recombinant factors, this half-life is so short. Now, pregnalization, that is one molecule, polyethylene glycol, addition of polyethylene glycol probably can increase the half-life of this factor. I don't know whether this preg form of molecules are available in the market or not. Polyethylene glycol, if you add this molecule,
polyethylene glycol is available. We do use
in these factors.
Yeah, polyethylene glycol present in the factors. I'm not aware because
increase the half life. No, that can increase the half life.
Availability of any material depends upon the demand. It was very nice of Dr. Sulagna to come up and
speak on
such a topic.
Thank you.
Very nice of you.
This,
thank you so much.
Actually, the topic is very vast and quite boring also, because every disease is overlapping features and...
No. Nothing is boring in hematology or hematopathology.
It is
important for us.
Maybe
to know.
In our region, this is rare because of the scarcity of the diagnostic test. We don't do all these factor assays. No?
That may not be 100% true.
Mm.
It's not because of the scarcity that of the diagnostic protocol that we don't get these diseases. No, that's not true.
Mm.
The fact of the matter is, it has a basic genetic predilection.
Mm.
And that genetic predilection is primarily race dependent.
Yes. Okay.
And
yes.
A lot of it is race dependent. So we are not in that, you know, in the genealogy, we are not in that race group.
Mm-hmm.
It's the Arab Jews, the
Arab
Palestinians,
Jews.
The Lebanese. Mm-hmm. The Jordanians, you know, the people in that area, some of the African nations, they are more affected than any one of us. So, but anyway, thank you so much,
okay.
Dr. Sulagna, for
sir.
A wonderful thank presentation.
Thank you.
We'll be surely having you back here after 3 weeks,
okay.
I bet.
Okay, sir.
Take care. Thank you. Please share
thank
the
you.
PDF of your lecture.
Okay, sir.
And we will put it up in the Google Drive. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.
Take care. Bye.
Bye.